Welcome to the History of Japanese Superheroes 2, Tokusatsu Boogaloo.
Yay!
The Japanese superheroes of the 1980s. Last year I did a panel where I covered the 1960s and 1970s and went over the birth of Ultraman and the creation of Kamen Rider and how those two franchises basically started a second boom of giant monsters and superheroes on Japanese television. Well, this year we're getting in the 1980s. Things change significantly once you get into the 1980s. At the end of the 70s, the Super Sentai franchise, as we know it, was basically created with Battle Fever J, which was the first series to give them a giant robot, because the giant robot toys from Toei's Spider-Man sold so well that they decided to do that. Unfortunately, I recently listened to an interview between August Vergone, the author of Eiji Tsuburaya, Master of Monsters, great book, by the way, where he interviewed the producer for the first two Sentai series, Go Ranger and Jaka, who quit the series because they were forcing the toys were forcing the writers to write for the toys instead of the other way around. So he quit before Battle Fever J started. Now, Battle Fever J was a gigantic hit. No matter the quality of the show, it was massively successful.
Massively racist.
Well, yes.
Miss America plays twice.
So at the end of the 70s, we've got Kamen Rider is at the top of its game. It's doing really well. Ultraman's had a couple of missteps with Ultraman Leo and an animated Ultraman series. And then Super Sentai is like surging and getting better and better and better. Which brings us to the 1980. In 1980, Tsuburaya tried to put Ultraman back on TV one more time with Ultraman 80.
The power, Captain.
Yeah, I could have done that better.
Drinking
You can't do it.
It's bouncing like it's trying to.
No.
No DLC for the winning.
Well, I should have brought my giant desktop, but that weighs like 30 pounds.
Well, you can think about it,
and then do it.
Just
blast those ads. Maximize the synergies.
So anyway, Ultraman 80 was started by director Noriaki Yuasa. Now, you might remember him. If you know what, that's actually Kamen Rider. If you remember a series called Gamera from the Showa era,
yes,
about a giant flying turtle and his children friends.
Yep.
Oh.
Better there.
Well, they were labeled in order, but and well, he after the fall of after the financial bankruptcy of Dai Studios in 1972, late 1971, early 1972. Noriaki Yuasa went to go work for Tsuburaya Productions, the people who made Ultraman. And his very first attempt for them was Ultraman 80, which is a very inconsistent series, to put it mildly.
What? Like, it's a monster of a week, but it has no, like, continuity?
No, I'll get to that in a second. Where's the volume on this thing?
That's the Wi-Fi.
Your function keys, does one of them look like a volume button?
Yes. F11,
F12. There's, oh, there it is.
Nope, you. Under. Yay!
Thank you.
Now I can import me.
There we go.
I have kids.
kind of disco.
Kind of.
Now he was brought on because he'd done the Gamera movies and they were really popular with kids. So they thought, well, you can recharge a franchise that's kind of flagging. Because if anyone's seen Ultraman Leo, Ultraman Leo was really bleak by the end. Like, all the heroes were dead except for the main character by the end of Ultraman Leo. They actually wiped out the entire science organization in one episode.
Wait, so they destroyed Gotcha Man?
Well, no, this was their science organization.
Oh!
Every Ultraman show has a scientific organization that hangs out with, that Ultraman's a part of. And so our main character is a school teacher.
I'm guessing he's also perpetually late.
Yes, he gets in trouble for that. But he's not just a school teacher, he's also Ultraman. And it's been years since there's been any monster attacks in Japan. So everyone thinks everything is hunky-dory and safe. Well, the whole plot revolved around this teacher, Yamato, and his classroom and the fact that he can't reveal who he is to anyone. And there's a scientific organization called UGM, which is fighting, protecting the Earth, but there haven't been any monster sightings in years, since the end of Ultraman Leo. Then monsters start showing up again. And so Yamato has to go from being a teacher to being a superhero. Still can't tell anybody who he is, because if he reveals his identity, he has to leave Earth forever. Ultraman rules. Also, he gets hired by the organization UGM to work for them, and he can't tell the school that he's working for them or he'll lose his job at the school. So he's kind of screwed either way he goes. So for the first 20 episodes or so, it goes along like that. And it's a really cool show, because you've got this dynamic with him and the school kids, you've got the dynamic with him and the military organization, and it's all him trying to balance his work-life superhero balance and make sure everything works out right. And then you get to episode 20 and they completely drop the whole school plot without an explanation. It's like, suddenly he's just working for UGM and there's no small children in the show at all and it gets really serious and the world gets attacked by blood-sucking balls. I don't know why. It's just like the first episode they did, it was called Attack of the Blood-Sucking Balls. And like these balls came down from space and started attaching to people and sucking their blood.
All right
then. Dispatched by the mother stroke, what's the deal with that?
And then, 10 episodes after that, they went back to a kid-friendly tone and they fought a baseball glove monster. So it was like wildly inconsistent in tone, completely dropped plots and subplots. They killed off one of the main female characters about 10 episodes from the end to introduce a new female character. And then, at the very end, when they're wrapping everything up, they reveal, oh, we made a robot duplicate of the girl you really liked who was dead. And I'm like, wow, that was really uncomfortable and awful. So it starts out with a lot of promise, and it's a really good show, and you can actually watch it on Crunchyroll. But it hits this point, and what happened was Noriaki Yuasa got sick of working for Tsuburaya because they kept telling him what his scripts had to say, so he quit. And when he quit is when they dropped the school plot and went into the more science organization plots. And he actually quit to go work on 1980s Gamera the Super Monster, but the less you hear about that movie, the better, because it's awful. It was a glorified clip show. Although it did feature Gamera meeting the space battleship Yamato, so... Now, at the same time, science fiction was becoming huge in Japan. Sci-fi movies were everywhere. And one of the most influential things in the universe was a little show called Star Wars that had come out in the late 70s and suddenly influenced everything. So everything started to be space-themed. Shows that had previously been about Earth-bound organizations suddenly became about space-based organizations. And the villains were all from space, even when before they were from Earth. And one of these was the 1980 Kamen Rider series, Kamen Rider Super 1. Who was designed to fight in space. He was designed to be a space colonist. He was altered to survive on alien planets and ended up having to fight an organization on Earth. And this was, well, Ultraman 80 was the last Ultraman to be on Japanese television, live action Ultraman series for 16 years until 1996 when they brought out Ultraman Tiga. So the Ultraman franchise at this point is pretty much gone. At least on television, but we'll get to that in a bit. Kamen Rider, meanwhile, had been the big show of the 70s. It had actually eclipsed Ultraman and become this huge phenomenon. And the year before, in 1979, they tried a soft reboot with a show they just called Kamen Rider. Now we call it Sky Rider to differentiate it from the original Kamen Rider, which was a back-to-basics, serious approach. Then came Kamen Rider Super 1, and most of the old Kamen Rider series, the hero was created by the villains. Most of them, not all. Because the villains took somebody and altered them into a cyborg superhero and were going to brainwash them, but never got around to brainwashing them. Which means, really important thing, if you are going to create cyborg supervillains, make sure you brainwash them before you give them superpowers so they don't turn on you. Kamen Rider Super 1, however, was built by NASA as a prototype human to survive in space. He's also notably different from other Kamen Riders in his color scheme. He's silver and black and red. Mostly silver, with a little bit of black and red.
So he was made by NASA.
Yep.
Does that mean that Kamen Rider Super 1 is effectively subsidized by the United States government?
Yep. He's the $650 man.
If you build them, we have the technology, but I don't want to spend a lot of money.
Now, you're familiar with form changes in Modern Kamen Rider, if you watch Modern Kamen Rider, where the hero will change to a different mode whenever he has to fight. This was kind of the genesis of that, but he doesn't change forms, he changes hands. He's got, I think they'll show it in here. Well, his normal form has this amazing fringe on his hand, like he's Mr. Yeah, like that. But each one of those different hands colors have different powers, and he can switch his hands at random. I mean, at will.
At random would be awesome.
Now, let me be Inspector Gadget. So this show didn't do as well as Toei wanted it to do. Which is sad, because it's actually a really good show. I love his design. The eyes are just cool. And so, unfortunately, Kamen Rider was going to take a break as well for a while. There wouldn't be a new Kamen Rider show on television for another 7 years. However, Super Sentai was about to just explode and take over everything. And you want to talk about some Star Wars influence? Let's talk about Denji Man. Denji Sentai Denji Man. Now, sadly, I don't have any subtitles on this show because nobody subtitled it yet. But,
right, we have work to do.
This was 1980 Super Sentai series. And wow. That's
wow! That was very 80s.
Apparently this one hadn't quite recovered from the 70s yet.
They had a lot of fun.
So they like cops in Florida?
No.
Are you sure? Because everything I see here is Florida, all over the place.
I don't know, for a second there I thought I was looking at
Okay, now the guy who plays Blue in this series played Battle Kenya in Battle Fever J, and we'll see him again in a few minutes when I get to 1982. And also, Denji Sentai Denji Man had the first transforming robot in Super Sentai. The series before this, they just launched the robot and it would like fly out and attack. In this series, the robot comes out looking like that, and then transforms. It's not a combining robot yet, we'll get to that in a bit. But this was the first transforming robot they had in Super Sentai. Now the plot of this series is very, very inspired by Star Wars. For one major reason, the villains are the Vader clan.
No.
Now, the basic plot is, thousands of years ago, as you can see from our cavemen in their
shorts.
In their lung cosplay. suddenly, there's this huge explosion, and this giant thing from space comes down and lands, and it creates Denziland, because it came from the alien planet of Denji, where it was destroyed by the evil Vader clan, invaders from another dimension. They came to Earth, and they their entire civilization was destroyed except for a dog.
A dog?
Yes.
Yes, one dog.
So they had to breed the dog with things to make other things.
No, the dog goes and finds people in the future to give superpowers to.
Alright. So
that was pretty close, actually.
Oh my god!
Yeah, basically, yeah, that's Luna from Sailor Moon. Actually, it's not. It's not a puppet.
It's a dog?
It's a chow chow.
Oh, that's why. Chow chows are evil.
Yep.
It's actually the only dog that's ever bit me is a chow.
And this is our creatively named Denji dog.
Oh,
he also is telepathic.
And apparently, speaks fluent Japanese.
Okay.
Is she paid?
Yes, well, obviously. But I love this scene because of what happens to her tennis partner here. The villains apparently just say, fuck this guy in particular. Let me see if I can find our villains.
Just fuck that one dude. His mustache is kind of like poor, sorry, so it makes sense.
Oh, I got
well,
like
it was the 80s.
That.
Everyone had it.
Got me sword
the poor, sorry mustache. Wait, what? This one only had one girl.
Yes. Okay. This is our main villain.
She looks so cool.
This is Queen Hedrian.
Yep.
She looks like a glamorous Rita Repulsa.
Same actress.
Yeah. Holy shit!
This is the first villainous role in Super Sentai for an actress by the name of Machiko Soga. You will see her again time after time after time.
And then...
I love her outfit, but she is the head of the Vader clan, who are determined to destroy the Earth and take it over like they've done so many other planets. And the only thing that stands in their way are the Denji Man team.
Holy crap, talk about getting typecasted.
Oh, so she's essentially in Super Sentai from here to Magic Ranger, right?
No, she shows up now and again.
Okay.
Let me see if I can find their...
We keep missing the dog!
We can't
oh, I'm doing martial arts inside a baseball stadium.
Okay.
That'll happen.
Okay, here's how they get their powers.
Oh no.
Oh, this.
And you can already tell what color they are, except for pink. I guess being the girl makes you pink.
Well, when yellow's a guy.
Pink.
Well, wait, yellow hasn't been a girl yet.
Nope, yellow had not been a girl yet at this point. Okay, this is the part that made me laugh the first time I saw it. Well, not the only part, but. The whole show has been pretty goofy. He's explaining to them how what they're going to do with their new powers and where their powers came from.
Those are some hot pants. What the fuck?
Okay, they are given magic rings of various colors.
Yes!
Oh my god, are they teenagers?
No.
Damn.
No, because that would mean pink would probably end up with heart. Nobody wants that power. It's dumb.
Oh, no!
But yeah, when I first saw this, I was like, red, yellow, blue. I'm like, all you're missing is indigo and violet. You've got the entire lantern spectrum. So anyway, Denji Man was a huge success, like massively successful. It was also underwritten by Marvel, who had been working with Toei since the Japanese Spider-Man. The next series, okay, now at this point there is no more Kamen Rider. There is no more Ultraman. All there is Super Sentai the next year in 81. And because of how successful Denjiman was, they did a direct sequel to Denjiman, the only time they've ever done a direct sequel in the history of Super Sentai. This show is amazing. It's also the only team that only had three members through the whole show and no girls. This is the No Girls Allowed Club.
Oh no!
Okay, I'm going to point out something that bothers me about this. The main characters are an eagle, are supposedly an eagle, a shark, and a panther. We just saw eagle. That shark. That's not a panther.
They didn't even try that. They didn't get a puma. They put a Ushia on there.
Okay, it's another thing you're going to notice. Battle Fever Day, Denjiman, and this series both have a girl diving into water in the opening credits. She's not on the team!
Does she even show up in the
show? She's one of the support characters. She's like their secretary.
They're Miss Fan Service!
Yes. This is our first combining robot. Although I don't know if at this point they actually had the robot yet or not. Oh yeah, there it is. Now what makes this a direct sequel is the fact that they decided to bring back the main villain from the last series. And by the way, you want to talk about Darth Vader inspired bastards? Look at that guy.
I was
about
to say,
they
better have somebody that the shoot assist can see everything.
They brought her back to life after the end of the last series. And to control her, they give her a cyborg heart.
That's a Dick Cheney heart.
That's timely. I guess you won't need this anymore.
That guy, by the way, is named Hell Saturn.
Hell Saturn.
Führer Hell Saturn.
Führer?
Führer. Like, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's Führer Hell Saturn of the evil organization Black Magma.
Wow!
He wants to take over the world and replace humanity with robots.
Oh, I almost got it.
Seems
like
legit motivation.
Okay, he's in the carpet,
and he's reaching through her.
Those are his henchwomen, the Zero Girls.
They look mad just over there. Genuinely upset about the parts. He just looks so irritated.
Well, they had to
do
that
take
like 10 times.
Probably.
Right.
She's like, his fucking gloves,
he
can drop in the
goddamn
parts.
And she gets a new headdress and a different look.
Oh, wow.
I like her new outfit better than the old one.
It's like a golf ball.
Four.
They're lashes, though.
So, Sun Vulcan, big success. There is a parody of Sun Vulcan created by a man named Hideo Akiyano called, what was it? Patriotic Sentai Big Japan. It was one of his Daikon films. If you're familiar with the Daikon films, before they became Gainax, they were Daikon film. And they made some live action ones, and one of them is Patriotic Sentai Dainopon, with such wonderful characters as Red Samurai, Pink Geisha, Yellow Tempura,
wow.
blue origami. I wish I had a copy of that, but it's like impossible to find a decent copy. There's a really low grade version on YouTube. But it's essentially them retelling the Russo-Japanese War as a Sentai show. So all the villains are Russians. And like really obvious Russians, and one of them's got the battleship Potemkin for a head. So we come to 1982. Now, Sun Vulcan was the last show produced with the co-production with Marvel. So at this point, Sentai's on its own. That Marvel has nothing to do with them anymore. They tried to market the shows that they had in the US and nobody wanted to buy them. Which meant we could have gotten Power Rangers in the 1980s if somebody had actually picked up this footage to Americanize. But we had to wait another 10 years. 1982, however, sees one of the most important changes. There was a man by the name of Hirohō Sasoda. He was a writer on the Sentai series. Actually, he'd been a writer for longer than that. He wrote on Gatchaman back in the early 70s. And then he started writing for Toei and started writing things like, he wrote a few episodes of the original Go Ranger, he wrote a few episodes of Jaka. He'd been a behind the scenes, you know, workman guy working on a few episodes. Well, they put Sentai in his hands and made him the head writer of a new show. Became so successful, he'd be the head writer until 1990. So he goes from 82 to 90 being the guy in charge of the entire franchise. The show he ends up with in 1982 is Dai Sentai Goggle 5.
Oh yeah. Goggle 5!
Which is based on rhythmic gymnastics. And ancient civilizations.
And explosions, apparently.
Oh, yeah.
Come on. That's a given.
That's a given.
No, but the explosions of this are main characters, unlike in most things. They're just supporting.
So they gain their powers from ancient civilizations, and they fight using weapons based on rhythmic gymnastics tools. Yeah, they have a killer ribbon attack. She's also awesome, by the way. And you notice there's something missing from these shows. The formula is almost there. But spandex hasn't come into the scene yet. They're still wearing just cloth outfits. I mean, they've got the robots, they've got the five-man team, the colors have all been established. Everything is, the model is set, but the costumes just don't look right to the producers yet. 82 also saw the launch of a new franchise. Ultraman had gone its course. Kamen Rider was taking a break. They needed something new. They had two responses. Shotaro Ishinomori, the guy who created the Super Sentai and the Kamen Rider franchise in the first place, came up with a new thing called the Toei Fushigi Comedy Series. Which I wish I had some to show you. I don't. Aww. There's only one episode I've got. And it's not even from the 80s, it's from the series from 1990. It was a hodgepodge series. It started with a pseudo sequel to an old show that Ishinomori had worked on in the 70s called Ganbare Robocon, which was a comedy robot show, live action comedy robot show. The sort of sequel was Robot 8-chan. And from there, it alternated between silly robot shows and cute animal shows, like weird, mysterious, cute fuzzball animals from space. By the time you get to the late 80s, the Toei Fushigi comedy show became live-action magical girl shows, which is what I've actually got an episode of, and I'm going to show that later this weekend in one of the overnight video rooms, called Magical Beauty Poetry. By the way, never just Google the word poitrine. Ever. I made that mistake when I was trying to do research on my lunch break at work. It's the French word for boobs. That was embarrassing.
Well, that tells me is that I'm not going to Google it in public.
Right. Now, the other creation at the time was they decided they needed a new solo hero. Since they had the Sentai teams, they needed something to replace Kamen Rider. That's where metal heroes come in. And the first of those is Space Sheriff Gavon. Come on, Gavon. That's another one of those encodes it doesn't like. Now the hero in Gavon is played by our old friend who played Denji Blue and Battle Kenya, Kenji Oba. He's legendary in tokusatsu, and that's his partner.
I got
his
text
message. Oh, okay. So, Gavon's a space sheriff, which basically means, well, he's a sheriff from space, who can transform into armor, and he has a transforming UFO that turns into a dragon, which is awesome. More people need UFOs that turn into dragons.
Why are some of his dancing scenes mosaic?
I don't know.
That was the choice.
Is that on purpose?
Yeah.
Now, in 83 and 84, there'll be two more Space Sheriff shows, Space Sheriff Sharivan and Space Sheriff Scheider. I am going to show Space Sheriff Scheider episode 38 at this convention. You, if you're at least interested, you have to see this episode. It's the Christmas episode. It is the most screwed up Christmas special I've ever seen in my entire life. There's an evil black Santa Claus created by the villains who wants to turn the children against Santa Claus and creates an anti-Santa cult featuring a giant altar with an upside down crucified Santa Claus behind it.
Yes!
It is. I showed this at a Christmas party this year, and everyone was like, Japanese children need therapy. Now we come to 1983. Spandex is finally in our Sentai show.
Yes.
And we get to a show called Dynaman. Now, Dynaman is the very first Sentai show to ever get an American adaptation. It's not a serious adaptation. It is one of the dumbest dubs I have ever heard in my life. And it has not aged well, because a lot of the humor is kind of...
dated?
Yeah! Which will bring me to, this.
Oh, God. I'm scared already!
Play.
It's my show for Dynaman! My good-looking Japanese friends from all over. You are able to leap tall trees is Donna Black. Frankie, the human up warbler is Donna Blue.
God, it feels like I'm just Cowboy, listening to the Spanish
is Donna Yellow.
And the
sweet slow gin is Donna Pink.
This was on the USA.
How old is the USA?
Always been around since the
70s.
I'm looking at the bill and I'm like, that was better than the hero.
Check this out.
Yeah, it's not very serious. And this is from a show that started out as pretty humorous to start with. Dynaman, the original Dynaman is actually a really fun show. There's an episode where they try to use a giant, a cowboy dinosaur man to cause earthquakes, which is really weird.
It's giving me the Ninjas flashbacks. Can we stop?
Now we come to 1984. 1984 is
a weird. Yes, everything is weird, Dawson. So we should fit right in.
1984 is a really important year. Not so much for TV, because we just had another Sentai series, another Space Sheriff series. It's what happened in the theaters that year that's really important. For one, Godzilla came back.
Yay.
After being gone since 1975. Ultraman also came back.
Oh dear.
And I want to show you the beginning of this movie, because you're going to hear a really familiar voice if you're a fan of 80s anime. Kamen Rider also came back that year, but only for a TV special.
Okay, that's the movie.
Listen for a very familiar voice. Yep, yeah, it's Goku. 2 years before Dragon Ball came on TV.
Oh my god.
Wow.
Jeez,
Ultra Baby.
Oh my god, this is so weird.
This
is
Ultraman.
Yeah, as
voiced by Grandma. Well, suppose the
grandma's
died. Yeah, she's voiced by Masako Nozawa, who is the voice of Goku to this day.
There's a little bit of Spanish. Looks like he's in neoprene.
Yeah. No, the Kamen Rider outfit, the Ultraman outfits are more like diving suits than anything else. And this movie also retconned the backstory of Ultraman Taro.
Oh
this
my
guy.
God.
Yeah. I see the wrists right there. Like, he's got to be overheating right now.
Oh, yeah. They couldn't wear those for very long. Those were pretty awful.
So they had so many stunt doubles.
Yep. Now, in 1984, we also got a TV series called Machine Man, which was created by Shotaro Ishinomori. I don't have any episodes of that either, because I can't find it. But it was a standalone tokusatsu show. No franchise, nothing connected to it. He just wanted to make a standalone show about a guy who was basically Superman in a Sentai outfit. Last survivor of an alien planet, comes to Earth with powers and abilities far beyond mortal men, dresses in spandex, and beats up robots.
average resume.
In 85, we got Dengeki Sentai Changeman, which was our Sentai for that year, which is the second longest Sentai in history because the series after it was having production problems getting started, so they had to commission three more episodes of that show to cover the gap before the next show could start. There was a problem that year. We also got a show called Brother Fist Bicrosser that year. Which is another Shotaro Ishinomori show. And this one, I really like this show.
He's shooting someone with a motorcycle.
Yes, he's shooting somebody with a motorcycle that he's holding like a bazooka.
Okay, just making sure.
Is someone else on it?
Yes.
Oh, lovely. That sounds like fun, actually.
I want to recut this with a soundtrack of Mass.
It looks, yeah.
Probably, I think around, I could probably find you a good audio file on
that.
Yeah.
Right?
I'm sorry, but the Blue Ranger had the white patties.
What?
They're two brothers who are given powers by aliens to fight an evil organization who has a demonic statue that creates diamonds when they make children cry.
I'm sorry, excuse me? Where can I sign up?
So all the villains
they
go around and they bully small children to make their statue create diamonds.
Still don't say anything, I can't see the beers going. Yeah, there it is.
There's a person on the motorcycle that he's shooting.
Oh yeah. The toy line was interesting. No, I really want to see a motorcycle with a trigger underneath it.
That would be an interesting motorcycle.
I'd love to see someone make like
So that show is actually really interesting, and the villains are ridiculous, but it's just fun to watch these villains create these horrible monsters that just go around and push children around. There's a whole episode where there's a monster just has these children on top of a rooftop, like, at them. He's not going to kill them. He just wants to scare them until they start crying.
Did Ishinomori's wife spike his natto?
Well, let me put it this way. Ishinomori was the guy who trained Go to Guy how to do comics. So, you know, when what you produced was Go to Guy, there's something wrong with you. Now we come to 86. 86, they started to experiment a little bit with how they did the editing on the Sentai series. They started to experiment with digital editing in the 80s.
All right.
Rewind that machine.
They wanted to do digital effects in a 1980s show.
Wow, let's see how this goes.
Before that, if you notice, most of the animation is what they drew it onto the cells. Like, they painted it onto the cells, and that's how you got all those laser effects and whatnot, or they put it in later. This was in video editing. They never did this again.
Oh god, let's see how bad this is.
This show is Flashman, which is actually a really good show. I talked to you about the trend for things to have a space theme in the 80s. This show is about five children who were abducted from Earth as infants, raised on an alien planet after they were rescued, and then come back to Earth to figure out who their parents are and stop the Empire that had kidnapped them in the first place. Later on, they find out that because they were raised in an alien environment, they can't stay on Earth for more than a year or they'll die.
What?
So they come home to try to find their parents and realize they can't stay.
Oh my god.
This is the bad part.
It's already bad, though.
Grown-ups and spandex.
That's by the way, Grown-Ups and Spandex is an awesome fan sub organization. I love those guys. Yellow is my favorite character in this show. Just want to put that out there. Oh, and because each of them were raised on a different alien planet, they have different abilities.
Oh! That's the first girl that isn't wearing pink.
Well, we've had yellows before this.
And a white. Oh.
A female red.
No, she's pink.
Which is
why they... It's called color.
What? Oh my god!
That's not what I wanted to point out. It's when they start deciding to destroy the motorcycles that let me show you what I'm talking about. Watch this. Not this one. Just wait.
I thought you said this is bad. This is amazing.
So was the byline for this show, we'll fix it in post?
Pretty much. They wanted to try out new video editing techniques, and well, they tried them. They didn't work. They never did that again.
But they tried really hard. God.
So at the same time this is going on, we're getting new, we're getting new Metal Hero shows. We're getting a new Toei Fushigi comedy series every year. But something's missing. Come 1987, that something comes back big time. Well, after it converts, apparently.
We can't. No. We're time. We can't do
it. Okay, Kamen Rider came back that year with a series called Kamen Rider Black.
Oh, yeah.
Now, if anybody's seen Kamen Rider Black, it is actually one of the best Kamen Rider series ever. It's wonderfully dark. and has one of the best villain hero dynamics ever. Two boys are raised as basically brothers after one of their parents, one child's parents are killed, and he's adopted and raised with another, with a young man who basically becomes his brother. What they don't know is the two of them are being raised to become potential leaders of an evil organization. What they're being raised to do is the two of them are going to be converted into cyborgs and forced to fight each other, and whoever survives gets to be king of the evil empire, Goldum. Of course, they don't bother to brainwash the guy before they convert him into a superpower being. So he escapes. His brother isn't so lucky. And so it ends up as brother versus brother. And it's really serious and really sad. And it ends with one of the brothers dying.
Oh, man.
Spoiler. Of course, the evil brother who dies, who by this point is no longer calling himself Nobuhiko, which was his name, he's calling himself Shadow Moon. And our main character is Kamen Rider Black, who was supposed to go under the name of Black Sun, so it was going to be Black Sun versus Shadow Moon. Well, Kamen Rider Black was hugely successful. They thought it was the best idea ever. So they made a direct sequel. Now this one is Kamen Rider. I don't know. It's not a terrible show, but it is prescription strength. They decided they'd throw everything out that they had with a Kamen Rider show before. Because everything before this was basically, our villains are from Earth. This one, our villains are from an other dimension in space empire. Also, this show got a horrible American adaptation called Master Rider in the 90s.
Yeah.
Oh,
it is
tight.
Oh! Yeah.
Oh, I remember that.
It was kind of like Zio.
Yeah, we don't talk about Master Rider. It was terrible. This was also the first writer show that gave us actual form changes. He could change into three different characters. Kamen Rider Black RX, he could turn into Robo Rider and Bio Rider. So it was our first time we got actual form changes where the whole body changed. Which would be a trend that would carry on later into the modern Kamen Rider series.
I have to admit, this is the most boring opening.
It really is, isn't it?
I'm like, this is really
exciting. I'm like, oh yeah, so
we're going to film and go down a runway.
It's the same take.
You can't
have
that
dribble
one
python.
Oh, I'm
going to
have to watch this one.
Well, that's the original opening because they couldn't show his form changes yet.
They were lucky that he came back to watch it.
Yeah, it's not the best opening, and the show is really, it's another one of those shows that's wildly inconsistent, because the last show ended really darkly, the world was on the verge of destruction, and everything was horrible, and his life was ruined. In this one, everything seems to be hunky-dory, and he's living with a family, and he has a job as a helicopter pilot, and they don't even bother to talk to us about what happened last time. And unfortunately, that would be the last Kamen Rider show we would get on television until 2000.
Right.
There were a couple of movies in the 90s, but that was the last one we get on TV. Now comes 1989. In 89, Metal Heroes were still going. Toei Fushiki Comedy Series was still going. Super Sentai was still going. Like, super strong. It was at its peak. It was its heyday. Everyone loved this show. And so they decided to throw a loop in. Before this show, every single Super Sentai series featured adult protagonists. They were all military people, or in their 20s, or, you know...
Or the girl.
Well, yeah. So they decided, how about we do a show with teenagers?
Yep.
But, at the time... This was the 10th anniversary. It wasn't really, But they didn't count the first two series anymore, since they weren't Super Sentai, because they didn't have giant robots. So they started the show with a gathering of the 10 teams. It was the first time we had a massive crossover in the history of Super Sentai. And so it goes through the basic history of Sentai, starting with Battle Fever J. And then we go to Denji Man. There's Goggle 5.
Where's that?
And Dynaman. Oh, quick fact, Dynaman was originally not even called Dynaman in production. It was called Baseball Sentai V-Leaguer.
Wow!
Which is why their outfits have a vaguely baseball uniform look to them. They actually have, I've actually seen pictures of the pre-production uniforms that have like their name written across it like it's a baseball jersey. But then they did some market testing and realized kids didn't think baseball was all that cool. So they made them scientists instead. Because everyone loves inventors. And that's Change Man. Flash Man. Mask Man, which I just finished watching the other day. Interesting show. That was 87 series. And then Live Man from 88. Which, by the way, if you ever want to see a Sentai series with the darkest opening episode ever, watch Live Man. Live Man, the tagline for the show is, "Friends, why did you do that?" The first episode starts on this academic island where all the geniuses, all these genius students are being trained. Three of them betray their friends and murder two of their friends to join the evil space empire because they promised them they could be smarter in space. Later on, they come back and murder every single student on the island by blowing up their spaceship they had built to take the class into space while they're launching it.
Wow.
Leaving only three survivors who become our heroes.
Friends, why did you do that?
Yeah.
It's a combo price.
Yeah, it's pretty bad. In fact, later on in the series, it turns out that they were betrayed by the guy that they betrayed humanity for, because what he wanted to do was create the universe's greatest geniuses so he could steal their brain and make himself smarter.
Because
he had 12 brains all gathered around from the smartest people on Earth, and he needed a 13th brain to complete his evil ritual of brainness. Yeah, it was an interesting show, to say the least, but it was really inconsistent in tone, because it had really super dark episodes, and then it had an episode where a dinosaur was eating a guy's butt.
Yeah,
oh, it also had an episode, this was a series where they added two new Rangers later on. They started with your, and by the way, you'll notice something in the 80s, they don't use the term Ranger, it's all man. You've got Denji Man, Bio Man, Change Man, Flash Man, Live Man, Mask Man. You get to 1989, and they use the word Ranger again for the first time since 1975. And from this point on, a lot of the show, the man title would start falling off, and you start getting more Rangers. For example, after this, you've got the last one after this was Five Man in 1990. And then after that, and that was the last show Hirohisa Soda worked on, because the ratings and the toy sales were so bad, they were considering canceling the show at that point. Yeah. Sentai almost died. So they're like, well, we'll make one more series and see if we can salvage this, and we'll turn it over to a whole bunch of unknowns and, you know, people who've been working behind the scenes. And they created a show called Chojin Sentai Jetman.
Yep.
Which became a smash hit and saved the franchise. One of the men they hired to do this was a young production designer by the name of Keita Amemiya. Keita Amemiya, it might not be one of the biggest names in the industry, but if you've ever seen his work, you'll know it instantly, the minute you see it. In fact, he's responsible for a show that some of you may have seen in animated form.
Uh-oh.
Well, he's actually responsible for a show called Tweety Witches, but which is an anime. But he was also responsible
for... It was an awesome anime, too.
Yes.
Even though the Americanized title is terrible.
Yeah,
it is.
Americanized title?
Tweety Witches.
Tweety Witches? Okay.
Yeah.
That's pretty awful.
Got that somewhere.
He's also responsible for a series called Garo.
Oh, yeah.
His production work, you will know anywhere when you see it.
That's the Japanese crazy girlfriend.
Okay, Garo, if you're not familiar with it, as a series, which this is kind of a diversion because it's done in the 80s, is a late night combination of a superhero show and a J-horror show.
Oh, I always thought funny the
oh, look, Ranger! He's responsible for the production designs for these shows.
I'm sorry, after seeing those, I want to play Bioshock again.
I was just thinking that.
Everyone says that, they're like, this looks twice.
Where's your rent?
Oh god.
So many bees.
So this guy,
I like the mask. The mask is cool.
So the guy who created this started off working on the Sentai series. Okay, I just want to show this because it's kind of badass. Real quick before the end of the panel.
Huh.
This is how you do digital editing, right?
Yeah. Oh god, I need goosebumps just looking at this.
Yeah, I'm actually going to show this episode tomorrow night. But yeah, that's
that kind of looks awesome.
That guy got his start working on...
I'm sorry, that was like possible. I was like, can I get a copy, please?
Yeah.
That guy got his start working on a show that he worked on that, and then right after that, he ended up working on a show called Zoo Ranger, which you may know as the show that inspired Power Rangers in the U.S.
I love the opening song of that!
Zoo Ranger? Oh, it's great.
Yeah.
By the way,
one friend is
if you're interested in ever watching Zoo Ranger, it's actually available on DVD in the U.S. now. For real.
With a legal translation?
Yes. You can buy it in the U.S. now.
Is Dragon Blood also available on DVD?
No.